Welcome, everyone, to this session of Center for International Policy Studies. We're really delighted to have Richard Gowan here with us today. You may have seen the commentary that he wrote for our blog site. If you haven't seen that yet, I really strongly recommend that you take a look at it. I believe the main themes of that commentary are the themes of today's talk as well. So at the very least, you'll have a written souvenir and main points from today's presentation. Richard is really extremely well placed to be talking to us today about the role of the United Nations in a, as he puts it, divided world. He is currently an adjunct professor at Columbia University School of International Public Affairs. He continues to be affiliated with NYU's Center on International Cooperation, where he was until recently the research director. And he's written really extensively. He has other affiliations too that you'll see in his bio with the information that was sent for this event. But he writes extensively on the UN, on security issues, on peace operations. He writes a weekly column for World Policy Review, which is excellent. I happen to be on the distribution list, and it's one of those, unlike the messages that I quickly delete, this is one that I read every single week. He has a very close knowledge of the politics surrounding and strategic challenges surrounding peace operations and current state of debates within the United Nations. And he has some very tough things and warnings, tough things to say and warnings to offer. So at this moment, as we're in the middle, obviously, of an election campaign here, peace operations have been raised as an issue in this campaign. So it's really perfect timing for us to be hearing from Richard and having this discussion. And with that said, please join me in welcoming him here to CIPS and to Ottawa.
Thank you, Roland, for that much too generous introduction. I'm sure you delete some of those columns unread. I'm going to talk about the role of the United Nations in a period of worsening international relations. And I'd really like to thank two groups of people for making this possible. Firstly, Roland and Isabel and the team here for inviting me to come and test out these ideas. And secondly, Vladimir Putin, Barack Obama, and Xi Jinping. Because last week at the UN General Assembly, they very helpfully demonstrated exactly how divided and how tense the United Nations has become. And I think that you will all have seen coverage of Putin's extremely tough speech to the General Assembly, his first speech at the UN for 10 years, in which he accused the US of behaving unreasonably. And you will also have seen Barack Obama's speech, in which he very much attacked Putin for his behavior at home in the Ukraine and in the Middle East. And this sort of rhetoric and this sort of exchange brought back memories of the bad days of the Cold War at the United Nations, when tensions between Washington and Moscow made international cooperation extremely difficult. On the other hand, there was some good news from the UN too. Yes, Putin was extremely aggressive, but his Chinese counterpart, Xi Jinping, actually came with a much more positive message. Xi did not use his appearance at the United Nations to bash Washington and bash the West. Instead, he announced a series of very serious commitments to the UN. He promised a new $1 billion fund for peace and peacemaking issues. He committed 8,000 Chinese troops to act as a reserve for blue helmet peacekeeping forces. And this really took a lot of observers by surprise, especially given the fact that relations between the US and China have also been through an extremely rough patch in recent months, with tensions over the South China Sea, tensions over cybersecurity and cyber spying dominating the headlines. And President Xi's trip to the US, which had preceded his appearance at the United Nations, did not seem to be a particular success. There was no real sense of warmth between China and the US. And yet there at the UN, the president, President Xi, was reaching out and offering increased international cooperation on peace and security issues, especially around peace building and peacekeeping. And I think this is a worthwhile reminder that although we do face a divided world, and we face a world where great power tensions are on the rise, as Vladimir Putin keeps on reminding us, those tensions do not make international cooperation and international cooperation through the UN impossible. They certainly make cooperation harder, but in a divided world, it's still possible for great powers to compete, but also cooperate. And I think that was President Xi's message. And that message leads into my overall theme today, which is, what can the UN do to adapt to a competitive multipolar environment? Very different to the international environment that we've lived through over the last quarter century. How can the UN adapt and how can the UN make peace in a situation where the biggest powers and key members of the Security Council are likely to be in a prolonged geopolitical game and to be constantly competing? Does the UN have a role in these circumstances? And so what I'm going to do is ask, can the UN play a direct role in easing tensions between Russia and the West, for example, over Ukraine? And what can the UN do to promote cooperation where it is possible between the big powers? In looking at the second question, promoting cooperation, I will make a special focus on the question of counterterrorism and countering violent extremism. Because if there is one thing that President Putin, President Xi, and President Obama share, it is a deep concern for the spread of terrorism in the Middle East and Central Asia. And this is one area which Russian officials in particular have emphasized as something they wish to cooperate on through the UN. So as the talk continues, I will turn my attention to the challenge of countering violent extremism. So the overall question is, what can the UN do as an institution, as a mechanism, to ease great power tensions? And this is not a new question, obviously. If we had been standing here in the 1950s or 1960s, we'd have talked about the role of the UN in reducing crises between the Soviet Union and the West. In 1956, of course, UN peacekeeping was launched to help one crisis come to an end in Suez. In 1962, during the Cuban Missile Crisis, the Kennedy administration very seriously thought about getting the UN to monitor the withdrawal of nuclear weapons from Cuba. The idea was that there would be a UN official in a Canadian plane, in fact, I think, circling over Cuba, watching the weapons leave. And even through some of the hardest periods of the Cold War, including periods in the 1970s, the UN still played a role in, for example, helping put peacekeepers on the ground to end the Yom Kippur War. It was understood throughout the Cold War that although the UN's options were limited, it was nonetheless a mechanism that could create buffers and could facilitate cooperation between the USSR and the USA. In the 1980s, the UN played an increasing role in helping bring the Cold War to an end. It was a UN official who set out the framework for the Soviet withdrawal from Afghanistan. The UN played a huge role in ending the proxy wars that had come out of the Cold War in Central America and Southern Africa, in cases such as Namibia. And in the 1990s, the UN continued to provide a framework for easing tensions between a badly battered Russia and the West. for example, by providing the framework for deploying peacekeepers to Bosnia, and later setting up the administration in Kosovo, which was a very serious flashpoint between Russia and the West. It's often forgotten that President Yeltsin, during his late, mainly drunken years, actually threatened the West with a nuclear strike over Kosovo. And although that was probably not a serious threat, it was nonetheless useful to have the UN to go into Kosovo and administer the country and bring that crisis to a conclusion. So for most of the UN's history, there has been a clear understanding that one of its central functions, although by no means its only function, is to act as a mechanism that assists the great powers ease tensions and get out of confrontations while saving face. But strangely, since the 1990s, I think we've focused on this work of the UN less and less. And in recent years, the idea that the UN should play a significant or central role in easing great power tensions has received much less attention than it should. There are a number of reasons for this. Firstly, the UN screwed up in a lot of cases. No one can point to the organization's performance in Bosnia as a model for peacemaking or peacekeeping. Similarly, failures such as those in Rwanda and Somalia continue to haunt the organization from the 1990s on. Secondly, and probably even more importantly, the Bush administration's decision after 9/11 to marginalize the UN sent a very clear signal to all parties that the US did not really see New York and did not really see the Security Council as a mechanism for great power politics. And that is a message which I think Vladimir Putin in particular took on board and continues to refer to. And so despite the fact that from the very beginning of his term, President Obama stressed his commitment to the UN and stressed his desire to break from the Bush era, there has been an enduring sense that the UN is not really where serious diplomacy gets done. Instead, the UN as an organization, and those of us who work on the UN, whether in policy terms or academic terms, has shifted its focus to what you might call second order crises, the crises that do not have very much geopolitical relevance or do not create much of a geopolitical threat, but nonetheless are serious humanitarian challenges. And so over the last 15 years, the UN has focused on cases such as the Congo, Darfur, South Sudan, and the organization as a whole has focused away from big power tensions and focused down on these major humanitarian challenges, safe in the knowledge that although the US and China might have differences over South Sudan, for example, they're not going to escalate to the level of full-scale geopolitical standoff. In some ways, this has been a huge success story. The UN has taken on crisis after crisis, and I think exceeded expectations in many cases. It now has over 100,000 peacekeepers around the world, costing roughly $9 billion, depending exactly on how you count. And those peacekeepers do not have a perfect track record. There are too many cases of sexual abuse by peacekeepers. There are too many cases where, frankly, peacekeepers do not go out to protect vulnerable civilians. But nonetheless, the overall record of peacekeeping is much more solid than that. And there are many, many cases such as South Sudan today, where you have blue helmets guarding tens of thousands. In the case of South Sudan, nearly 200,000 people who might otherwise be killed. And the UN has worked out in some cases how to build up states that had fallen apart in places such as Liberia and Sierra Leone, while also running more and more humanitarian operations. The UN's humanitarian budget is currently $16 billion a year, another record. So when we think about the UN, we now primarily think about it as a mechanism for helping the vulnerable in trouble spots that are not first order geopolitical points of tension. And for those of you who are interested in the UN from an academic standpoint, you will know that the study of the UN has increasingly focused down on questions of human rights, local perceptions of the UN, community perceptions of the UN. By contrast, as Roland pointed out in a recent article, there hasn't been much study of what the UN function is geopolitically and how the UN fits in to increasing great power tensions. In the UN itself, quite rightly, African countries are increasingly setting the agenda for peacekeeping in places like Somalia and Darfur. And it's often African voices that really dominate debates of what the UN should do in trouble spots such as the Eastern Congo, a very positive development. But again, this takes us further and further away from the tensions between Beijing, Moscow, and Washington. The fact that the UN is not focusing on geopolitical tensions also has impacts in countries like Canada, because very frankly, I'm sure that many of you in this room feel strongly about the UN, care deeply about the UN, but in contrast to the Cold War era, very few of you would actually say that the UN is really important to Canada's national security. And a number of Western countries, including the Nordic countries, have followed the same path and increasingly viewed the UN not as a luxury, but not as a necessity either. There's been an assumption that national security issues are dealt with through NATO, or for some Europeans, the European Union, and the UN deals with humanitarian issues. And so while I know there's often a lot of regret in certain Canadian political circles about Canada's reduced interest in the UN, that's part of a wider pattern that can be traced to the fact that the UN no longer seems so central to international politics as it once did. The problem about that assumption is that geopolitics is actually returning to the UN with a vengeance. There was a prologue in 2008 when UN peacekeepers found themselves on the front line during the Georgian War. But what it's really been in the last 3 or 4 years, starting with the Libyan conflict, going through the Syrian and Ukrainian conflict, that we've suddenly seen great power tensions come to dominate discussions at the Security Council and at the UN once again. We have seen Russia and the US, with China supporting Russia and Britain and France supporting the US, clash repeatedly over Syria. We've seen an ongoing debate, which Vladimir Putin referred to again last week in New York, about Libya between the great powers. And the Ukrainian issue has been discussed repeatedly in the Security Council without any progress. And these debates over Syria, Libya, and Ukraine are slowly poisoning Security Council politics and making it harder for the big powers to find solutions to other crises. For example, earlier this year, when there was very great concern about rising violence in Burundi, Russia and China essentially blocked any action by the West on Burundi as part of a broader competition in the Security Council between the great powers. So suddenly, great power politics is back at the UN, and in cases like Syria, it's threatening to paralyze the UN. Well, it has paralyzed the UN for 3 or 4 years. And so the pessimistic observer might say, the UN's glory days are over. If we are returning to an era in which the great powers are increasingly in competition, where they are increasingly unlikely to agree on common positions about conflicts, then the UN as a whole is going to drift back into passivity and will not play a central role in global affairs. It's tempting to be pessimistic when you watch some of the debates that we see in New York. But I would argue that it's absolutely essential that we remember the lessons of the Cold War and see that the UN can still act as a mechanism to ease tensions, as it did in the 1950s, 1960s, and 1980s, between the great powers. And we need to go back to some of those historical lessons to see what the UN can do for international security as the world becomes more divided. Even in the cases I've mentioned, the UN has had a role. In the Syrian case, Russia and the US have used the UN as the primary channel for communications and mediation between the parties, sadly unsuccessfully. The UN also provided a framework for the 2013-2014 mission to get chemical weapons out of Syria. The UN is still struggling to find a political solution in Libya. And even in Ukraine, where the UN does not have any serious political role, UN humanitarian agencies are working across the front line between Ukrainian-held territory and rebel-held territory. I was speaking last week with a UN official, a humanitarian official who was recently in Ukraine, who described the process of negotiating through 26 checkpoints to get food in and out of the Donbass. So even today, in these cases, the UN is playing a mitigating role in conflicts that are either directly involving great powers, including Russia, or have become entangled in the current era of great power competition. The UN has a mitigating role in great power competition. The question for me is, can we expand that role? Can we imagine a United Nations that, while continuing to deal with crises such as those in the Central African Republic and South Sudan, which remain immense humanitarian challenges, also has a role in tackling great power competition and contributing to all our security by facilitating reductions in tension between Washington, Moscow, and potentially Beijing? I think it is possible. I don't think that the UN is ever going to be the place where Vladimir Putin and Barack Obama make big bargains. But the UN can play a role in supporting those bargains. And I think it's worth remembering that back in the 1980s, UN envoys such as Martti Ahtisaari, the former president of Finland, often acted as shuttles with Moscow, dealing with crises like that which blew up over Kosovo. I think that it's essential that the UN should, at the highest level, bring in more experts on Russia and more experts on China, who can advise Ban Ki-moon and Ban Ki-moon's successor, who will be appointed in about a year, on how to deal with these tensions. Ban's team currently is full of experts on Africa and the Middle East, but has very, very few people who understand politics in Moscow or Beijing at all. And a very, very simple step towards giving the UN greater leverage in future crises involving China and Russia would be to ensure that the next SG, the next leader of the UN, has a team who really understand all the great powers and quite literally speak their languages. I should say that I am not promoting myself here. I speak not one word of Chinese. And while I actually grew up to the age of three in Russia, my knowledge of Russian would not get me very far with Vladimir Putin. It has largely faded away. But it became very clear, in fact, during the Ukrainian crisis that there was literally not one senior Russian specialist in the whole of the UN system. And that needs to be something that is resolved. I also think that we need to think through what the UN would do if it was asked to provide a peacekeeping force in somewhere like eastern Ukraine. Currently, there is a peacekeeping mission, although it's a civilian mission, in the eastern Ukraine. It's run by the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe. But both Russia and Kiev have at different times talked about putting in a blue helmet force in eastern Ukraine. And I think that that is still one possible conclusion to this conflict. Now, let's imagine what that force would look like. It would not look like the sort of force that we put into Liberia or we put into South Sudan. It would need, I think, to involve some countries with long histories of peacekeeping that have stayed away from peacekeeping for some time. And I would include Canada potentially in that group, although Canada's NATO membership would be a complication. We need to imagine setting up peacekeeping forces that can act as buffers between between Russia and the West, if we need to in Ukraine. We also need to think even further ahead. We need to look at the conflicts in the South China Sea and say, well, what sort of naval or airborne international presence might you need to help deconflict tensions in the South China Sea between China and its neighbors? We need to start looking at peacekeeping options that take us far beyond what the blue helmets do today, so that the UN can act as a mechanism to assist the great powers reduce tensions in future. We also need to look at what the UN can do on the one area that I've referred to where all the great powers do see a common interest, which is countering violent extremism and countering terrorism. While the great powers differ over the sources of terrorism, differ over exactly who is a terrorist, there is no doubt that there is a common interest amongst all the major capitals in tackling the threat of terrorism. And that is true whether it is the Islamic State in Iraq or Syria, or it is the resurgent Taliban capturing Kunduz last week. The United Nations struggles with the threat of terrorism. It is such a politically sensitive issue that UN officials often shy away from it. But nonetheless, we do need to see how the UN can be used as a mechanism to address this threat. Ban Ki-moon and his team are currently working on one part of the agenda for countering violent extremism. That's the soft end, that using education and social tools to reduce the appeal of terrorism. And that is a natural role for the UN and less controversial than others. But we have to recognize that in future, we may need to deploy UN peacekeeping forces into countries where Islamist terrorists are a threat. It's already happened. In Mali, currently, there are UN forces on the ground facing attacks from Islamist groups. On the Golan Heights, Al-Qaeda affiliates have kidnapped UN personnel. And my suspicion is that in future, given the trends in conflict that we see, we will be looking to deploy more and more stabilization forces and more UN forces into countries affected by terrorism. There are plans at UN headquarters to deploy up to 15,000 peacekeepers into Syria, should that become necessary and possible at any point. There are discussions at UN headquarters of deploying 6,000 or 7,000 peacekeepers into Libya. Deploying those forces will be much, much harder even than the Mali mission, where over 40 peacekeepers have been killed. Very frankly, if you put blue helmet forces into Libya or Syria, they're going to find themselves in extremely dangerous and volatile situations. But nonetheless, all the great powers may conclude that they have an interest in putting a UN peacekeeping force into Damascus or into Tripoli in the next few years. And a key test for the UN will be whether it can deploy stabilization missions in those cases that can survive and can contribute to long-term political order and reconciliation. That is a huge challenge. Just like the possibility of deploying peacekeepers to the eastern Ukraine is a huge challenge. And we need to think, and there is some good thinking now emerging, about how UN forces tackle the threat of terrorism and violent extremism, learning from Mali and other cases. It's very clear that UN forces cannot actually run counter-terrorism operations in the way that special forces from the West may do, but they can help contain terrorist threats by reassuring communities that they are safe despite the presence of violent extremists. To do that, you need much better equipped forces than the UN normally deploys. You need much stronger command and control mechanisms than the UN commonly has. And frankly, you need Western countries to re-engage with UN peacekeeping. And some Western countries are doing that. The Netherlands has led the way, sending peacekeepers into Mali. And so if you were discussing the possibility of Canada returning to UN peacekeeping, I think you should be absolutely clear about the fact that Canadian peacekeepers are not simply going to go and sit in Haiti for a bit. We may need them on the front lines in Libya, or we may need them on the front lines in eastern Ukraine. And this is, in the words of Samantha Power, not your grandmother's peacekeeping. So we need to change the way the UN does business around terrorism. We need to find ways that the UN can be relevant in crises involving the big powers. And we do, as I say, have to do all that while maintaining our commitment to countries such as the Central African Republic, where the UN has peacekeepers but still has decades of work creating stability and feasible states. This is a huge task. It is a huge task in the face of geopolitical competition and tensions. It is frankly made much, much harder by the lack of money in the international system. There are not resources on the level that the UN needs for its humanitarian and peacekeeping work at the moment. So what I'm arguing for may be a rather sort of grim utopian vision of the UN, because although I'm emphasizing the tough challenges, it may just be utopian to believe that the UN will ever get the resources to do all this. But I think we can take some steps, and this is where I want to conclude. I think we can take some steps to strengthen the UN and make it more fit for purpose in an era of great power competition. And I want to focus on three dimensions of that. The first dimension is the role of the Secretary General. As I said earlier, Ban Ki-moon leaves office at the end of next year. His successor, who many people want to be a woman, and I think probably will be a woman because there are very strong female candidates, will also probably come from Eastern Europe due to UN traditions. And I think that it's crucial that whoever the Secretary General is, she or he should, as I said before, focus on getting top-level advisors who understand Russia and China and their visions of great power politics so that they can engage in direct diplomacy with Moscow and Beijing in a way that puts the UN at the center of de-escalating global crises. The second question is, what can middle powers such as Canada do to assist in the sort of change that I'm talking about? Because I hope that I've suggested, at least through this talk, that there are real national security issues for Canada, whoever wins the election, to engage with the UN because of the state of the international system. I think that governments such as the Scandinavians, the Dutch, and also the Canadians have a very important role to play in advising the UN on how to deal with the threat of terrorism and how to deal with the threat of violent extremism in places such as Syria and Libya, building on your own experience in Afghanistan. I think it would be even better if you could send some peacekeepers to help in those countries if they are required. Finally, what can the big powers do themselves to make the UN useful to them in regulating their geopolitical competition? And ultimately, the Secretary General and well-meaning governments can do whatever they like, but the big powers need to see the value of the UN to themselves. I think that there is an opportunity signaled by President Xi in New York last week for real cooperation between the US and China on overhauling the way the UN peace and security system works. I think that we can build on the offer of peacekeepers and the offer of money from China last week and use that as the basis for bilateral talks between Washington and Beijing about making the UN more relevant to the crises we have today. And I think that is a huge opening and one that the US should seize. I don't think that that will mean that relations with China over cybersecurity or the South China Sea or East China Sea get any easier, but I think that it is very important that Washington signals that it wants to work with China on UN issues after this very, very big offer of support from President Xi. As for Russia, we must wait and see. Vladimir Putin came out of the UN last week riding high. I don't think that right now he wants to have serious discussions about strengthening the multilateral system with the US and Western counterparts. But Putin has, I believe, got into a trap in Syria. I think that he has embarked on a war that he will find it very, very difficult to get out of. And I believe that in 6 months' time, or a year's time, or 2 years' time, Russia may come back to the UN, having burnt its fingers rather badly in Syria, and will be more willing to talk seriously both about stabilizing Syria, but also steps that can be taken with the US and with China to strengthen the UN's counterterrorism capacities and also strengthen UN diplomacy more generally, so that we don't get back into crises like the one we've seen in Syria, where great power competition spirals out of control and claims hundreds of thousands of lives. And that is still the overall point, which is stopping great power competition, which is a necessary and inevitable characteristic of the international system today, leading to so much bloodshed. And I believe that we can avoid the bloodshed if we take some of the steps we've taken. Some of the steps that I've described. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. And we'll move quickly to a question period. I'm going to take the liberty, if you don't mind, of asking the first question. But let me just repeat our house rules to everybody, those who haven't joined us here before. We ask that you please wait for the microphone, identify yourself, and ask a question, ending in a question mark. A very wonderfully wide-ranging yet detailed presentation, which is characterizes always your analysis, and I'm sure there'll be lots of questions about the geopolitics, and I'm interested in that too. But I have a much more prosaic question. You mentioned that there is some prospect in the medium term, potentially, for the UN to become involved in a Syria situation. In the near term, though, the meeting last week, hosted by Barack Obama, was in a sense calling for contributions and filling of gaps in existing operations. And I wonder, whenever we hear about this, I think we hear again and again that what is needed from Canada now, I mean, who knows what might be down the road, but what might be needed from Canada now is these so-called enablers, very specific capabilities. I was wondering if you could just say a couple of words just for information about what are the missing capabilities and how can a country like Canada potentially contribute to that? And then I'll let you call your own questions after that, if you don't mind. Thanks.
The simple answer is this. As I mentioned, the UN has over 100,000 personnel worldwide today. And that reflects the fact that the UN can pretty much always find standard infantry to deploy to its missions. Getting infantry battalions from Bangladesh or African countries is still relatively straightforward, although the quality is mixed. What the UN lacks are the assets that can make a mission mobile and give it teeth. So the UN lacks helicopters, although that gap has been reduced, other forms of transport aircraft, engineers, field hospitals, intelligence units, special forces who can add some punch to a UN mission. These are what is missing, in addition to some planning capacities and other technical capacities. And to be absolutely honest, no one really wants a country like Canada to send us another battalion of troops. I mean, it would be nice, but it's not the priority. What the UN is after is aircraft, engineers, and medics in particular, who can provide mobility, provide secure bases for UN operations, and in the case of the medics, save soldiers' lives, because actually the UN has poor medical evacuation systems that need strengthening, and that's a common concern for existing and potential troop contributors.
Questions? Yeah, George Jacoby, retired diplomat, and I head up a Middle East study group of the Canadian International Council here in Ottawa. And related to the Middle East, you mentioned a couple of conflicts, but I wonder if you could speculate a bit on the future of a UN role in a final settlement of the Israel-Palestine situation, where bilateral negotiations are blocked, and particularly the role of the UN in ensuring border security, a future two-state solution, and international security, and confidence building, and state building in the new Palestinian state, should it come about. Given that the UN has already provided a context in its previous resolutions for a final settlement of that solution, what is its future role?
I have to say that although the UN currently has an extremely good representative based in Jerusalem, Nikolai Mladenov, the UN's overall leverage in the Israel-Palestinian dispute is as low as it's ever been. The Obama administration very deliberately decided to focus on bilateral efforts to resolve the crisis, and that has lowered the UN's influence. Nonetheless, I think that there is one potential diplomatic way forward, which is for the Security Council to pass a new resolution laying out a clear timeline and parameters for a deal between Israel and Palestine. The US is currently blocking that, but France and others are lobbying for it. Should a deal become possible, the UN will inevitably have a very major role in terms of supporting a new Palestinian state, in terms of bureaucratic support, channeling economic support. I don't think that is in doubt. And this is one area where the fact that you have many UN officials with very, very long experience in the Palestinian territories is a huge advantage. The other question you refer to is security. Might it be possible to have a UN peacekeeping force or a UN observer force on the borders of a new Palestinian state? I think that is possible. Israel and the US would probably prefer a NATO force, but that is unacceptable to the Palestinians. Arab countries might suggest an Arab League force. That would be unacceptable to Israel. And so, as so often, I think you would come back to the UN and you would need a UN operation watching over Palestine's borders. Again, I think this would have to involve countries from Europe and Canada that have the trust of Israel as well as Palestine. So this would be another case where you can imagine a significant Western return to UN peacekeeping, rather as in 2006, Europeans sent a lot of troops to South Lebanon to end the war with Israel. There's a question.
Thank you, Richard. My name is Paul Chapin. I'm a retired Canadian diplomat as well, and currently the executive editor of a digital publication on international security affairs. I want to congratulate you, first of all, on the general tenor of your presentation. It's kind of refreshing to hear something a lot closer to the truth being told about the UN than the normal pieties we hear about the organization. My concern is that notwithstanding the brutal honesty in some respects of what you're saying, there's still a sense there that people are groping for a new role for an old organization, hoping that this old organization can be tweaked a little bit here or there, and all of a sudden it'll click in and it'll be the exact solution to the problem. I have spent enough time on UN affairs in my 30-year career to know what happened to various efforts at reforming the UN. And it seems to me that the fatal flaw is always that people don't really want it. Either the big powers don't want to cooperate to get something done, or at a regional or more local level, the parties to a conflict would rather not actually settle. They'll settle for a truce while they rearm. I'm reminded constantly of Edward Luttwak's observation: give war a chance. It does have the benefit of settling problems. When you say that some of these issues are going to take decades to resolve themselves, you have to say to yourself, isn't that another way of saying they will never be resolved using the instruments we have today? So my question is, should we be thinking even more boldly about either ditching the UN altogether or doing some really radical surgery on the UN, driven by the big powers who do really want to make it work? And if those who are prepared to don't want to cooperate, put them aside and carry on despite.
I share your instinctive skepticism to UN reform. I was quoted, I think, in an interview last year. Someone said, what advice would you give to a young person who is interested in Security Council reform? And my response was, take up a more productive hobby like basket weaving. As you say, UN reform is an endless, slow, and often frustrating process. And I don't imagine that anything I'm describing would make the organization click into place or produce a perfect UN. I think what I'm looking for is, what are the steps that we can take practically to deal with real threats that we see? And this would involve a lot of innovation, and in some cases it would succeed and in some cases it would fail. So I'm very realistic about the chances of success, given what I'm describing. And I personally worry about it, you know, suggesting that any organization sends soldiers to Syria or Libya. I think that it could be a disaster for whoever goes in. Nonetheless, I don't think we're at a political moment where you can do radical surgery. I think that China and Russia in particular want to work through the UN that we roughly have, and we therefore need to find what common ground we can with them about how to make that UN function better. As I say, I think China has sent some very, very interesting signals over the last 10 days or so about that, and I would pursue that. But I still think that even if you explore what the Chinese are open to or what Russia is open to, you're going to have to work with roughly within the parameters of what we've got. And radical surgery would create too many political rifts and sensitivities and might actually do more harm than good.
Thank you very much, sir. My name is Josh Levin. I'm a doctoral student here at the University of Ottawa. I study peacekeeping. And you mentioned the chances for Sino-American cooperation at the UN and how China was, you know, one of the largest, I think the largest pledge for new peacekeeping troops with 8,000. And they've been ramping up their troop contributions since 2005. And I've, you know, you hear explanations about why China is getting more involved in the UN, why they support Security Council resolutions more and more. Some of them argue that it's a strict economic interest in sub-Saharan Africa or something having to do with, you know, strict national interest. And I was wondering, from your perspective, what do you think is driving this kind of Chinese re-engagement with the UN?
I think it's very interesting that despite its growing power, China is often very cautious at the UN. And on issues such as Syria, Chinese officials deliberately shelter behind the Russians on a lot of issues. And I think for some time, those of us who are critical friends of the UN have been hoping that China would raise its game at an even greater rate than it has so far. I think that if you look at Chinese deployments of peacekeepers, they're often connected with very specific economic interests. For example, sending an infantry battalion to South Sudan, where Beijing has energy interests. What is interesting about the big offers that President Xi announced last week was that they're not just an incremental increase in China's potential commitments to the UN, they are a step change. And it is possible that this is all for show. I mean, a pledge of 8,000 troops is not 8,000 troops. I will believe in those 8,000 troops when there are 16,000 boots on the ground, as it were. But nonetheless, if this is a real pledge, if this is a real offer, I think that it represents a strategic investment in the UN, which China has not made before. And the origins of that are hard to divine. I don't think that very many of us saw it coming, but we definitely need to explore it and take advantage of it.
Hi, my name is John Packer. I'm a director of the Human Rights Center and professor of law here at the University of Ottawa. Thanks, Richard, for your analysis. I know well-informed and sharp as usual. But if you allow me a couple of queries about it. First of all, the topic you have of making peace in a divided world is obviously beyond the UN, right? A much larger question. So we find ourselves in a rather narrow discussion about the UN. And even if we're more optimistic, I mean, the UN was significantly reformed in 2005, for example. So if we just say that there are possibilities of development, and I would say the Chinese, I take them more than on their word. We know about their three C's policy since year before last, a very substantial change in strategy and so forth, for which there are compelling reasons. They need solutions to their complicated own problems. So we can look at UN reform itself. I wonder whether it's a little narrow how you're describing it. You know, peacekeeping, even is peacekeeping the right word? There's almost no traditional peacekeeping anymore. It's complex emergencies. And fit for purpose, what does that mean? I mean, if you look at Canada, if you're talking about the capabilities you mentioned, you know, we don't have them, basically. And we're not likely to get them anytime soon. It'll take a long time to get them. You know, so for example, if we take up two situations you mentioned, Ukraine, I would say forget Canada and peacekeeping role in Ukraine. Not only the NATO complications, you call it, but you know, our politics puts us on the right end of the NATO membership. You know, so I don't think we're remotely going to be considered there viable as a peacekeeper, and we won't have the kind of capacities to do it. But if you talk about South China Sea, you know, there's a place where we might be received. But we don't have the capabilities. We've got two frigates that bump into each other and two submarines that are in dry dock basically all the time because they don't function. So we don't have the ability to do much in the South China Sea. So I would rather think about what Canada's real contributions might be in a different kind of multi-dimensional global peacemaking. And there I would go to kind of more upstream. And I'd like your view. You talked about the incapacity of the UN around for instance, Department of Political Affairs, you know, not having Russia specialists. Well, you know, we're worse than that. I mean, we had not only no Russia specialists, we had wrong people and wrong in the positions, Middle East experts and Latin America experts dealing with Ukraine. Canada has a substantial background and much to contribute, I would argue, on governance in terms of transition, justice, management of diversity. These are all closely linked to the SDGs. This has a lot to do with complex transitional arrangements in much of the world. Isn't that a place where Canada could play a much more robust and effective role where we could marshal the capacities? So that would be my link to that is my second question. Might that be best delivered, not through the United Nations, but either through bilateral arrangements or through regional organizations or other similar arrangements?
I think you're absolutely right. I mean, the title Making Peace in a Divided World could go in many different directions. And substantively, I fully agree that regional organizations, most notably the African Union and some other African organizations such as ECOWAS, are going to play a larger and larger role in peacemaking and peacekeeping on the continent. And I think that is an extremely positive development. It's a development which in some ways the UN has helped midwife by giving support to those organizations. But I would imagine that 10 to 15 years from now, African organizations will very much set the agenda in future conflicts on the continent. And that is a positive thing. And I believe that, well, I know that Canada already does a lot of work in support of the African Union. I think that it could expand that support in many of the ways you describe. And that should be seen as beneficial both to the AU, but also to the UN, because the more the African Union can do on its own, the less pressure there will be on the UN to fill in the gaps. I hadn't realized you had so few frigates. I'm sure the last time I went to Halifax, I saw at least three boats, and none of them were bumping into each other. But I mean, if this is the reality that you face post Afghanistan, then perhaps one should slightly lower one's expectations and look at where smaller Canadian military contributions could still make a difference. For example, right now, in the Central African Republic, which I've referred to a number of times because it's going through a spasm of violence, I believe it's true to say that I calculated this recently, 0.002% of the peacekeepers come from NATO nations. And I believe that if you put Canadian staff officers, I'm sure you have some engineers, into somewhere like the Central African Republic, it could make a difference. And it would also be a good learning experience for those forces. Central African Republic, also an incredibly good case of where the civilian capacities you describe would be useful. Because there, precisely, the challenge is setting up a viable, diverse state with multiple faith groups. Also, the CAR is a Francophone country, which is a plus. So, I mean, while I'm focusing on the geopolitical conflicts, there are many, many, many other conflicts where Canada could provide both civilian and military capacities. And the Pope is going to the Central African Republic in November, so maybe you can pledge some soldiers to go with him.
Hi, my name is Sidi. I'm a master's student in international development and globalizations. I have two questions. My first question is that we often see a disconnect between the resolutions voted at the General Assembly and what happens when the Security Council meets. Often we'll see that the General Assembly have more popular, like, South or third world oriented sentiments, and then it completely falls apart when it gets to the Security Council. And my second thing is that there seems to be a real disconnect between national sentiment and national politics and what happens in the UN. Like, if we look at the migrant crisis, we're seeing UN officials saying some things and leaders in Europe saying completely different things. We're seeing African leaders basically bashing UN-affiliated organizations like the International Criminal Court. In the US, UN bashing has become a sport, basically. So what could the UN do to perhaps reach out to national publics and to kind of make them understand what the UN really stands for without losing its real mandate?
Okay. On the first point, the disconnect between the General Assembly and the Security Council. The reality is that one of the very few things that binds together the US, China and Russia at the UN is that they don't want to be beholden to the General Assembly. They like their privileged position in the Security Council. And that's actually one reason why I believe the UN may have a role as a mechanism for promoting cooperation between them, because at least they're all in this little club in the Security Council that's making all the decisions where they can cooperate. The General Assembly reflects the views of all 193 member states. The Security Council reflects the views of five. And that is the source of the disconnect. The politics is completely different in the two bodies. Can the UN make itself more popular? Look, the UN has many, many campaigns, and there is not one pop star alive who has not appeared representing the UN in some capacity. Michael Douglas, the famous actor, is well known as the UN's representative on non-proliferation. I have no idea why. The UN is remarkably good at getting its message across, and yet the organization continues to suffer a very poor reputation. I would, however, pick up on one issue that you referred to more substantively, which is the refugee crisis. I do think that it's absolutely essential that UN officials speak out for the refugees in Europe, speak out for their rights, call on Western governments to give more money to help those refugees, because there is currently a big funding shortage. Now, the UN should just do that because it's the right thing to do, helping the refugees, but it would also have, I think, if the UN can get its message across about how it's on the side of the suffering and the vulnerable, I think that would have long-term positive effects on how it's seen globally as well. So that's one example of a crisis which I think the UN could both resolve, but also through resolving, improve its overall reputation.
We're going to have to wrap it up there, and I'll take this opportunity to thank you, Richard, for your presentation and excellent questions from the audience and your thoughtful replies. What I especially appreciated was your practical approach, a realistic, I think, as one of the questioners pointed out, realistic assessment of the limitations and the obstacles. But you never resort to cynicism, and I think you know, it's that combination of realism yet a sense that there are practical things that can be done that is a useful contribution. And when I hear presentations like this, I'm often reminded of that old quote from Dag Hammarskjöld, the former Secretary General of the United Nations, that the UN isn't there to deliver us to heaven, it's to save us from hell. And you've given us at least a few ideas about saving ourselves from hell. So I hope very much that those ideas will gain broad interest and attention. And in the meantime, on behalf of everybody here, thanks so much for coming here and sharing your ideas with us today. Thank you.